Welcome everyone to today's devotion. We are done with the book of Hebrews, the book of Galatians, and now the book of James. So we have covered a lot of the New Testament. So if you've been following with us over the last several weeks, you've already read 2.5 books of the New Testament. Now, Lord willing, by the time we finish the Gospel of Matthew, which is where we're beginning today, we will be out of quarantine, done with social distancing, all of that sort of stuff. But Matthew is 28 chapters long, and we do this 5 days a week. So this is going to take us over a month to get through, but I think it'll be really beneficial. We begin in Matthew 1. And there we see two things happening. The first is the ancestry of Jesus. The other is the birth of Jesus. Although we think of Matthew and Luke as our nativity stories, Matthew's is actually quite short. It's only a few verses regarding the conception and birth of Jesus. He spends more time in the nativity scenes about Jesus as a toddler, and not necessarily as an infant. But let us begin first with the ancestry of Jesus. No doubt this is one of those passages in Scripture that we skip. We don't like to read the genealogies in the Bible, where there's Genesis 4 and 5, 1 Corinthians 1 and like half the book, and all the other ones. But Matthew 1 is as important as all those other ones. Not just because it is the ancestry of Jesus, and so it connects Old and New Testament, but because of what it tells us about Jesus. Notice there in the very first verse of Matthew, it says, "The book of genealogy of Jesus Christ, the son of David, the son of Abraham." Now, on the surface, that is a perfectly fine genealogy. Because the two things Matthew wants you to know throughout the entirety of the book is introduced right there in the first verse. Notice that Jesus is the descendants of two people, the son of David, the son of Abraham. You see, as the son of Abraham, he is fully and completely Jewish. He is a son of Israel, a descendant of the founder of the Jewish people, Abraham himself. But it isn't just that he's a Jew, but it's the tribe by which Jesus is from. Jesus is from the line of David. That is, he's of the tribe of Judah, but more specifically, within that tribe of Judah, he is a descendant of David. David, of course, is the king of Israel, the greatest king of Israel, whom God promised that his throne would know no end. And as you come to the end of the chronology of the Old Testament, there is no king on the throne of David. There is an absence of this, and many Jews felt as if God had violated his promise. But the promise isn't that just there would be a human sitting on an earthly throne, but that a descendant of David will sit upon an eternal throne, and we will call him Messiah. So right from the beginning, in the very first verse, we are given all this information about Jesus. Jesus is the son of Abraham. He's the son of David. Thus, Jesus is the king of the Jews. We've done this some at the church on Sunday mornings and Sunday nights and Wednesday nights. But you can easily trace that theme of kingship from the very first verse to the very last verse, and throughout the whole book, we see how Jesus is king. For example, in chapter 2, we meet the wise men, the magi, and they're iconic characters for the nativity, but we really don't think much about who they are and what they're doing. In short, the wise men are king makers. They come to essentially crown Jesus king. And we know this because in the narrative, they come to the supposed king of Israel, Herod the so-called great, but they do not recognize him as king. But then they see this toddler Jesus, and they bring to him gifts of a king, gold, frankincense, and myrrh. You can go to chapter 3, and there we're going to have the baptism of Jesus and other important events. But there we meet John the Baptist. What is his message? Repent. Why? The kingdom of God is at hand. Jesus' message in chapter 4, his first words in his ministry are the same. Repent, for the kingdom of God is at hand. Also in chapter 4, we see the temptation of Jesus. And what is one of those temptations? The Satan says, I will give you all the kingdoms of the world. You see, that's not really a temptation for me, because although part of me thinks that would be all right, but it's not my calling. Jesus is king. And so this is a very real temptation for him. Likewise, chapters 5, 6, and 7 are the Sermon on the Mount. Here the king gives his law. And then we get stories of Jesus exercising authority over the natural world and calming storms, sickness, and the supernatural world and casting out demons. All of this is to build the argument that Jesus is the king. He is the Son of David, the Son of God. And all of that is introduced right here in the opening verse and in this ancestry. So verse 2, Abraham was the father of Isaac, Isaac the father of Jacob, Jacob the father of Judah and his brothers. Notice the emphasis on Abraham, and then through Isaac and Jacob, he's a descendant of Judah. Down to verse 6, we see that, and Jesse the father of David the king, and David was the father of Solomon by the wife of Uriah. Notice again the emphasis on kingship. David was king. And who is Jesus, therefore? He is king. In fact, Matthew concludes this genealogy by saying, verse 16, Jacob, the father of Joseph, the husband of Mary, of whom Jesus was born, who is called Christ. So all the generations from Abraham to David were 14 generations. From David to the deportation of Babylon, 14 generations. And from the deportation to Babylon to Christ, 14 generations. So you see, not only is he a son of Abraham, he's a son of David, and he's the fulfillment of the promise made to David. He is the Christ. Well, that leads to the birth of Jesus. So we know what his lineage is, but how is it that Jesus was born? And Matthew emphasizes in the concluding verses of chapter 1 that Jesus was born of a virgin. So you'll see there in verse 18, it says that Mary had been betrothed to Jesus before they came, to Joseph rather, before they came together. And she was found to be with child by the Holy Spirit. So that is that she conceives apart from natural conception, but as a gift from God. In fact, it goes down later and emphasizes it again. Verse 25, that Joseph took his wife and knew her not until she had given birth to a son, and he called his name Jesus. Now, let's just notice briefly and highlight this briefly, that Mary did not stay a virgin. That is a myth really created by, honestly, the Catholic Church. And I think there's some real danger in articulating that view. And one of the problems is, and you get this in the Catholic Church, that perpetual virginity is a higher level of spirituality than faithfulness within a marriage that raises children. Now, God gives intimacy as a gift to be enjoyed by husband and wife. And so I believe, and the text is very clear, Joseph and Mary did enjoy marital intimacy, and it would have been wrong for them to be married and not enjoy marital intimacy. And furthermore, we know that Jesus had half-brothers and sisters. In fact, we just spent 5 days studying the book of James, who was the half-brother of Jesus. Jude is also a half-brother of Jesus. So we know that they were together, but before the conception of Jesus and before the birth of Jesus, the two of them, Mary and Joseph, had never been together. But although that's the nature of the conception and birth of Jesus, that's not the only thing Matthew is emphasizing. He wants us to know who Jesus is. He's already shown us in the genealogy that Jesus is the King of the Jews by his ancestry through both Abraham and part of that's Judah, and then of course David. But notice what this means that Jesus has been born. He says in verse 22, "All this took place to fulfill what the Lord has spoken by the prophet. Behold, the virgin shall conceive and bear a son, and they shall call his name Emmanuel." And then he translates the Hebrew for us, which means God with us. You see, the story of Jesus isn't just that a human was born and he became a mighty king. He's a true and better king than David. And so Jesus literally is God with us. And this is the sort of kingdom he brings. He brings not the kingdom of David, but the kingdom of God. And the specificity of this kingdom is made clear the last verse of this chapter, that Jesus is born. And what does Joseph name him? Jesus. Jesus is the Greek word for the Hebrew name Joshua. It simply means the Lord saves. You see what kind of kingdom this is? It is the kingdom of God by which God draws people into himself whom he saves, and he sets them apart from the rest of the world. The kingdom of God is worldwide. And Jesus draws us to himself by the means of salvation to be part of his work here on earth, and is an eternal work that will not be completed into eternity. All of that in an ancestry and in a brief story about how a child was conceived. Lord willing, we'll see you guys here tomorrow, and we'll look at Matthew chapter 2.